Alright, so I think we're getting started. Yeah, I think everything is going well right now. The stream is working, perfect. How this is going to be, we are going to have Nico on the chat. So he will be trying to answer also questions over there, in case I'm busy, I don't know, disassembling the DS right at the moment or something like that. But mostly the idea is the following. So we're going to get started with the custom firmware, which is basically this firmware we have patched to enable the TV out directly without the need for any homebrew. Hello everyone, people who's joining still, thanks for joining. And so yeah, as you can see, I have here lying on my desk a few boards. I have some cards over here, DS in kind of good shape, more or less. So yeah, that's pretty much the idea. We'll get started. We are actually going to show how the custom firmware is flashed into the DS Lite. I'm going to show the process. It's pretty well known. It's quite similar to installing Flosme, but anyways, and after this this streaming, what we're going to do is we're going to publish a detailed tutorial or steps to patch your firmware and, well, in a sense, enable this custom firmware. So basically, we are going to do it this way because we cannot share content that is copyrighted by Nintendo, otherwise we will be in problem. So we cannot share directly the binary of the custom firmware. You know, we can say, here's the download link for this modified firmware. We can't do that, basically because it contains copyrighted software or assets, if you prefer, from Nintendo. So we cannot do that. Instead, what we are going to show you is the procedure to get the custom firmware installed, which is not difficult at all. So it just requires a couple more of the steps, which is going to be the patching step, but that's actually quite trivial. So that being said, I think, yes, GBA mode does work with this mode. So it's great for GBA macro modes and for playing DS games that you couldn't play with a DS with only one screen. So as planned, well, what you're going to need before, in case you wanna reproduce this when you get your board, or you wanna install the custom firmware after this streaming is end. So you need, firstly, a flashcard that works with your DS Lite. Here I have a gateway blue card, just because it's the one I had handier here. But I had a couple of Air Force and M3. All of these, as long as they work on your DS, they are fine. Alright, so you will need two things for flashing your custom firmware. You need the flashcard, you need the binary of the custom firmware, and you will need a way to short one of the pins on the motherboard of the DS. That's pretty easy to do. Let's bring the DS here. Okay, so I tricked you, this DS doesn't have the top screen, okay? This is the ribbon cable that will usually be plugged into the board. But in this case, our board replaces it. Which, by the way, is something that we've been asked a couple of times. Yes, when you have this board installed, the DS TV out, you can actually boot your DS without top screen, of course, because it kind of simulates the presence of a top screen, which is essentially the same as the mod you can find on Google and so on, which is basically soldering a resistor. Well, this is more or less the same, except the resistor is already over here on the board, and that's the job for us. So for now, I will remove this screen when we are not going to use it. This DS boots perfectly fine. I think I will need to configure it. Yes, it's not configured. It doesn't have my nickname and so on. So I will just quickly configure it and show you how we can install the custom firmware. So for the custom firmware, we don't need to tear down the DS. We will only need to actually remove this part that covers the battery. That's pretty much it. All we need to sort that pin. And as I said, you can use whatever flashcard. I'm just going to use this one. Hi Dorito, welcome. Soldering a resistor or putting in a rubber pad? Yes, that would work too. Hello Matsonazzo. Yes, all those tricks work. In fact, you can even solder short the pins on the board. But I'm not doing it on this console. I don't like having them shorted them all the time. But for example, Nico has them that way. He just put a bit of solder over there, and that works perfectly fine. So we're going to reboot the console now that I set up the profile and so on, and we are pretty much ready to install the firmware. So we need to turn down the console because DS Lite, as far as I know, don't have plug and play. That was introduced with the DSi, and we need to remove the cover of the battery. That's pretty easy. All you need is a Phillips screw, the one that has the head with only four hinges or four places to put it. And I believe you cannot see it. Well, yeah, it can be seen, but it's basically the leftmost hole that gives your way into the SL1, I think it's called. I don't recall exactly, but I think it's that one. So we will need to sort that. I'm going to use the worst method of all them to sort it, which is the all reliable tinfoil stick. This is absolutely hilarious, but it works, and why not? If this piece of nothing works, then you can do it. But as I said, if you want to tear down the whole console and put a bit of solder, it will work too. So basically, we will need to put it like that and flash the firmware. So to flash the firmware, we are not going to use a flash means installer. We're going to use, let's boot into the flash card. We're actually going to use C-Torch flasher, which is basically a kind of genetic flasher, which can flash any binary to the flash memory of the DS. So yep, that's pretty much it. You can search for it, but we will leave a download link to it on the page once it's finished this stream. So let's get to it. I have here the flasher. It's called Firmware Manager, or FW Manager for short. And yeah, it works as a generic flasher. So basically it says, warning, this tool may damage your system, use at your own risk. Of course, that's something you need to know. If you are flashing your firmware and the first time you fail, your battery goes out or something, then it's, well, it's not game over. It's very easy to unbrick a DS. In fact, I have unbrick mine couple of times, if I recall correctly. But once our custom firmware is installed, it will have a recovery mode, which basically means if you for some reason try then to go back to a stock firmware and you fail, you won't brick your consoles because you can basically recover them. That recovery mode, or recovery mode, is based on flash means recovery mode, as we'll show later. So let's get this board over here. Hi, can you upload this one down? Yes, we're going to, well, the streamer is going to be available on Twitch, I believe for 2 weeks after it's finished. But yes, we'll download. I download it and probably will upload to YouTube or whatever is good for yeah. So let's try to flash the firmware. This is, all you need to do with C-Torch flasher is just press A. And we'll make sure to have the battery well pressed. We don't want to unplug it while flashing the firmware, otherwise this will be a fail. So we just press A, and now we need to press start to start the flashing, which I'm going to do. Okay, flashing firmware, and it's already starting to flash because there's a small percentage of the flash that is actually writable, that you can write without shorting the SL1 bridge, without breaching it. But there's another part of the memory that is not writable without shorting it. So basically, because I had already installed a custom firmware on this unit, it's already flashing the part that it's writable. But if it's the first time you're doing it, you will probably be asked to do it from the beginning. All right, so now all you need to do is to put this into the SL1, which I will show again is this one. Just need to put it, and okay, we're flashing. So CTORT's flasher, it's slightly slower than Flasmis, for example. Flasmis is quite fast, actually. I don't know why this is. I bet it was programmed directly on the bare metal. But for CTORT's one, it's quite a bit slower. It's on 85% and going on. Yeah, this is the boring part of the process, but you only need to do it once. So that's excellent. And there we go. So we're done. I think you can kind of see it more or less. The camera doesn't focus very well on this. And we can pretty much now turn off the console. So next step after flashing it is obviously checking that it has worked. So what we need to do is to boot the console again. And yeah, it works perfectly. It goes to the main screen, everything works, pictochat, games, etc. So now we truly have the custom firmware. Yeah, CTORT is an absolute madman. He has developed exploits for the DS Lite, for the PS2, yeah, almost for everything. PS4, yeah. In fact, I believe the DSI hacking Discord that we have now, I guess some of you guys are from there, was founded after Champion League, and I followed, I believe it was one of CTORT's tutorials, but that was like 5 years ago on exploiting DS games, and we exploited some games, and after that we founded the Discord. So yeah, that's pretty much it. Okay, so this works. We're going to turn the console down. At this moment, when we plug the console in, it's already outputting TV signals. Okay, but the board is installed, so there's really nothing much you can do here. But yeah, let's get started. I don't want to leave this in the back burner anymore. So we need to remove flashcard, the GBA port, of course. We're going to remove the battery. When you remove the battery, the settings are lost, but doesn't really matter much because you set them when you start the console again. So yeah, no big deal. Yes, Jericho is also involved. He has had a very important contributions to the project, of course. This is mostly Nico, Jericho, and I. And we also had help from Rocket Robs during the test before we had the custom firmware. So yeah, big thanks to them, of course. And they are the real ones working hard behind the scenes. We've been working on this project, I think we're in March now, since December, so yeah. Okay, now this is the pretty standard part where you disassemble the console. So there's basically a couple of Phillips screws over here, and this one won't fit for some reason. Yeah, it will. And we also have this special Nintendo 3 wire. I'm not sure how they're called, but they are like three-side screw. Yes, Joricom has a lot of great projects. He's also the creator of GBA Runner, which is an hypervisor for the for GBA, but for the Nintendo DS. Wait, let's remove first all the Phillips screws. There's basically one here and two on this, behind this rubber thing, so we just need to remove them. One, two, yeah, they go out pretty easily. Now, back to the Phillips screw. And I will show you a couple of things once we are inside the DS. As you've seen, this DS boots without top screen. That's because it has the resistor mod to boot without top screen, but that mod is perfectly compatible with the TV out board because basically they do the same thing, so the DS doesn't complain. And yeah, this is the proper screwdriver. We just need to remove three more screws and we are basically done inside the DS. So this will be quite fast. The DS Lite is quite easy to disassemble compared to the DSi, at least in my opinion, and the 3DS. I guess they just were able to reduce the hardware to the minimal expression, which is good. Now for opening it, what I like to use is a guitar pick, so I don't need to use my nail. Basically, you wanna with your fingers maintain these two buttons, so you can see it can go out pretty easily. But I will just use the pick over here, and that's it. This back case is pretty easy to remove. Yes, we'll leave it here as I'm going to use it later. Okay, so what do we have here? On a DS with upper screen, you will have disconnected over here like this, and the connector of the ribbon cable is on the other side of the board. That's where we are going to plug the TV out board. So of course we need to flip the board. I will leave this, but if you have a DS with top screen, just know that it's going to be connected, and these two cables, one of them, the white one, is going to be plugged into a socket that is here, antenna, and the other one is going to be plugged into this chip. This chip is the Wi-Fi chip of the DS, and it's where the firmware is actually stored. That's why I said it's very, very easy to unbrick a DS Lite if you brick it, because this is removable, so you can put it on a, let's say, on another DS that boots and swap it and flash a firmware to it. So it's trivial to unbrick as long as you have another working DS Lite. So what I'm going to do here is just remove the L and R buttons gently, because I don't want to lose the, there's like a tiny spring here that maintains it. So I will just remove it. They go out very easily. Just treat them with care. I spilled it anyways. So this is the chip, as I said, it can be removed very easily. It's a socket that is plugged here, so no big deal. I'm going to leave it plugged because we don't really want to remove it, otherwise the DS won't boot. Now there are two remaining screws on this board that we need to remove to install the TV out board. These two are here. So here's the first one. We'll just remove it. No big deal. And the second one on the left should be relatively easy. Alright, so we are now working with the bottom part of the DS. Now this depends on your DS. If you've never disassembled it, the bottom screen, let's see if I can show you. The bottom screen is going to be kind of paste with some kind of sticky material. I don't know what is it, but in my case, because I have disassembled it a couple of times already, just pushing on the bottom screen will make the whole board go away, which is what we want. And I'm just going to remove it gently. I'm not even going to remove the bottom screen flex, which is here. It's really small and I don't want to remove it, because otherwise I'm going to spend 5 or 10 minutes just trying to plug it again, and we don't want that, of course. So let's see the other side of the DS. This point we can actually use the part of the other case to place the, let's see if this fits. Yeah, it fits. Be careful with the power button and so on, because they only have one position where they fit. So what do we have here? I have the resistor mod, which I've installed here. It's not the best place, but it kind of works for me. And here we have the socket for the top screen, which usually will go here and will be plugged like that. So this is where we are going to plug our TV out. Now, a few considerations before doing this. Here we have the board. I have different sizes of ribbon cables. I will use this one unless we have any problems, but I have a larger one which works equally well. So yeah, pretty much all you need to do is plug it. All right, but these boards, a few tips I can give you from match testing is always make sure you plug it correctly. Try not to bend the ribbon cable, and we'll get later to that after we test it. But there are several ways to reassemble the console together. So basically, I think the cleanest mode of them all is the one Nico did, where he cut a little, not hole, but a line in the L button, and the ribbon cable just go out of there, and it's almost unnoticeable from a normal button. But in my case, I'm not going to reassemble it fully after we test it, so no big deal. The ribbon cable can be plugged either way, so I'm just going to make sure I plug it correctly. It's very important that it is plugged with enough strength and until the end. Otherwise, we will get some image errors on the screen once we connect it. Because if the ribbon cable is buggy or is not connecting properly, sometimes the signal may have some noise because the ribbon cable is not making contact correctly. So that's pretty much the reason behind it. All right, I think this is plugged correctly, though I could plug it with a bit more of strength. And this is pretty standard connector for ribbon cable. But if you are planning on soldering this by hand, let me know in the comments, because I can give you a few tips to solder them manually. Because we have tested at least two methods to solder them. And yeah, some of them are better than others if you do it manually in your house or whatever. So now we are going to go to the TV, which I unfortunately have on another room, so I will switch here the screen, but it will be painless. I have a couple of games here that we're going to test. I have Spectros, and over there I have Pokemon, and I have Mario Kart, which are classics for DS, and we'll see how this works. So yeah, that's pretty much it. I'm going to swap over here to the TV. Nico, you're over there. Let me know if I missed something, but I think this is pretty much the standard procedure. Spectros was a really good game. Too bad they didn't continue it after the Wii, but it's perfect because it has some 3D graphics that are amazing, and on the TV they look really good. So yeah, everything's fine. Let's get to it. I will take like 30 seconds to get there, don't worry. Oh, so apparently you aren't getting any audio from the from the TV side. Okay, that's going to be, yeah, worse now because I'm not on the TV side. But basically, yeah, this should be working. Oh, this is, I think this can be solved pretty easily, but I'm not completely sure why it's not working. This should be working, to be honest. Let's just check it over there. Yeah, basically now it was working previously because I did the test and it was working. I don't know why you can hear me now, but I will just make sure everything is fine over here. So yeah, this will be working. I don't know why. Well, basically what I'm going to do is we're going to plug the DS and we are going to plug it, but with the TV out turn off. Just because I want to see that it boots correctly, which I'm sure it is going to do. And after that, I will just plug it into the main screen. So, yeah, if it works, which is probably what is going to happen, I will try to bring it over here and just test it over here while I will leave some game running, okay? That I think that should work, and it's pretty much the best part, but it's weird that it's not working. Let's just get to it.
Okay, I think you should be able to hear me now, which I'm on the TV side with the DS, or at least more or less you should be kind of able to hear me. I don't know, the audio is going to be as perfect as I wanted, but I guess this life hack will work for now. Yeah, okay, so I think you can hear me. This life hack will do the trick for now. So let's turn on the DS, okay? So now you can see it. I don't know if you can see the this, but it's basically booting. Okay, so it asked me to configure again the profile because I don't have it configured because we removed the battery. No big deal. The TV out, as far as I remember, I'm not sure if it works while on the reset configuration menu, so I'm just going to speed run over it. And we're going to boot straight into the main menu, firmware menu. Okay, birthday, setting save. Yeah, rebooting. All right. So I have rebooted the console. Now it's time to turn on the TV out. All right. Excellent. Excellent. It works. And the signal, it's quite clear, actually. I don't know if you were able to see it, but it's quite clean and looking pretty, yeah? So this means we have plugged the ribbon cable, the flex cable, correctly with enough strength. Let's see if everything works. Yeah, I think I just swap the E, all right. It's on the bottom part. So now you cannot see it, but basically the, what is it called? The bottom screen of the DS does this interlapping mode in which it shows the two screens and so on. This board is a bit, it takes a couple of presses to work, but mostly it's working. Well, this button is not perfectly working. Okay, this was, I had one button that had some problems, but those problems are solved quite fast, just with the use of some cleaning solution for the bottom parts, because they don't make contact the soldering perfectly. So when this happens, the best way to troubleshoot it is just turn it down and reconnect the flex cable again, and that usually solves the problem. And that's probably what's going on here, because I didn't plug it with a lot of strength. As you can see, it goes out very easily, and we don't want that. We want to plug it with a strength and press real hard the part of plastic that makes it stay correctly. I'm going to do the same on the TV side, on the DS side, sorry. So as you can see, this basically goes out very easily from the DS. So let's just plug it again with a bit more of strength than before, but not too much, because you could damage something. So again, I'm booting this up. And yeah, now I've plugged it even worse than before. I think that was on the DS side, so I'm just going to do it once more. It just takes a couple of times doing this to get used to it or get the trick. But once you've done it twice, and even better, once you plug it correctly and it's working. Okay, I see the problem. I don't know if you can see it, but I've plugged the flex cable not correctly aligned to the socket. So that was a very stupid fail on my side, but can be solved pretty easily. Right. So no big deal. But just the shenanigans you find when messing with this kind of boards with flex cables. But it's better than not having TV out, of course. So now we just plug it correctly. All right, that's good. We reconnect the RCA cable, white to white, yellow to yellow, and red to red. And we're ready to turn it on again. Anyways, this board is one that I tried soldering with a new technique, which is basically using a hot air gun. So that's pretty much it. Okay, let's see what's going on over here again. Yeah, this is the live streaming problems. You try to do everything as fast as possible and it doesn't work because you're doing it fast. So let's just go back and try to put it again. Let's see.
Right, so we're back at the working desk, and we deal. Basically, I've been trying to do this too fast and misaligning the connector too much. So, actually, it doesn't matter which side of the plug you put. This is every 2008 kids with dream. Yeah, kinda playing Pokemon on the TV. So, this is probably the most delicate or problematic part. Not problematic, but basically these flex cables, these ribbons always mess up. All right, yeah, it works. So I think now I have plugged it correctly, but just in case, I'm going to bring this other larger flex cable, basically just in case something happens. Hello, Big Macara in the chat. And okay, I think we're ready. Now, what you were really expecting, let's try the games. We want to see the games. Okay, so let's go again to the TV side.
All right. So we're back. And now what we need to do is again plug it. And right now this will be outputting audio and video because the TV is, the DS is completely plugged and the board is running. So as soon as I connect the RCA, yeah, this will start working. Okay, perfect. We got clear signal. And we got sound now. Okay. Okay, good. So let's just boot up Spectrobes game to test. I didn't bring the button. But yeah, sound works. And all right, we have video. I'm going to reduce a little bit the sound from the TV. The sound is flawless. It's just like the original, really good quality. So that's pretty much it. Now, from the start menu, you can already, oh, I moved this a little bit. Okay, no problem. You can start playing and whatever you want to do. But mostly what we are interested in now is the buttons and so on. And I think I haven't plugged completely correctly the board again, because one of the buttons, the most important one, which is screen swapping, which is just a button. It's simple electronics. It's no big deal. It's no need to hack anything, just a button. It doesn't work. So yeah, we're maybe rushing this a little bit, but I soldered this board with a new technique, which is basically using a hot air gun to manually solder it. And it works pretty well, but this button didn't solder perfectly. So when the ribbon cable fails and the button fails too, then you cannot swap the screen. But mostly, as you can see, booting games and everything works as expected. In these games, we have spectroscopes here. We have the top screen now on the TV, and we have the bottom screen, of course. We have the bottom screen on the DS Lite. No big deal. Now let's test what we have over here. Okay, Mario Kart. This is a pretty standard game. So let's just unplug it. Everything else from the DS, from stock DS works. So what do I mean with stock DS? I mean GBA games on the hardware side, no emulation, just pure hardware games. DS games, of course, you can have both screens, one on the TV, one on the board. But most interestingly, if you have a GBA macro and you have as well, if you want to have a GBA macro but playing DS games without TV, you can do it with the swap mode, which basically shows two screens, the top and the bottom one, both on the bottom screen. That's pretty nice. We'll get to it later when we go back to the desk, because it can be shown better there. So again, we usually start this with the TV out board turned off, and then we turn on the DS and we turn it on. Oh, we have some, okay. Yeah, I think my ribbon cable is a little bit damaged because I've used it too much. So if it keeps scrolling, I will just put the other one. And we basically, well, I've been basically using this board a lot for tests. So yeah, it has a lot of, let's say, not damage, but the ribbon cable has a lot of work hours behind it. So let's just put Mario Kart and see how it works. Oh, yeah. More reliable Mario Kart. For this game, it's pretty much top screen that we need. Because the bottom one is purely, how do I say, the map of the race. Oh, yeah, this is looking nice. Okay, the signal quality is very good right now. Yeah, of course, we are not going to boot Mario, sorry, because I haven't placed the buttons right now on the board. But as you can see, this is working really well, and I don't know if it can be appreciated right now in the streaming. Let me just turn down the volume a bit. I don't know if you can appreciate it really well because of all the compressing and streaming, but the quality is really, really good for a Nintendo DS from 2006. So yeah, Mario Kart passes the test very well. Now we will go back to the desk and clean the buttons a bit so I can swap the screen. Yeah, let's just try another game. Let's try Pokemon Black, which is another classic from the DS. And I just want to show you how it works. The Pokemon Black intro is quite cool. But of course, I need to show you the bottom screen. Let's see if it works after we clean this. Okay. Pokemon Black Edition. Oh, I forgot to turn the TV out. So, yeah. That's it. Oh, I move again. Okay, it's good. I'm just placing my finger on the ribbon cable because it's a bit wiggy, like it moves, and the signal goes woohoo. Yeah, I'm going to totally replace it because this one is is not making no good to Pokemon intro, which, to be honest, is, yeah, emblematic, at least. So this is all just without plugging the board. Not plugging the board, reassembled the DS, but it works equally the same. If you want to see the videos, I think Nico has some of them on his Twitter, and as well as some of the capture tests on YouTube, where he just plugs the RCA to a capture card. And well, this is actually looking better than I was expecting. And nostalgia is just hitting right now. But okay, this works perfectly. So pretty much this is the all the big deal of installation. Of course, you need to solve the how do I reassemble the board, but that's pretty easy, as I mentioned earlier. Okay, this works. I'm just going to turn it off. And we'll go back and clean these buttons because my soldering skills are really bad and these things happen to me. Okay, let's get to it and let's change the flex cable too.
All right, back in the lab. Now, yeah, Nico has put the YouTube video on the, I think that's on the capture card. I haven't checked it, but I'm pretty much sure it's that one. So, now, let's firstly disconnect completely this. Just to mention, this is not the final board you can get. This is the 1v1.1 revision of the board. But the boards that you can get from the from GitHub are the 1.2 version, which is basically the same. It just corrects some problems in the seal screen that so basically the places where you had to solder the components weren't marked as well as possible, and that's pretty much the deal with the revision, so you can get the good revision one. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to get the TV out board, and before changing the flex cable, we're going to use, no, not this one. Where's the isopropylic alcohol, which is basically you can use to clean the flux that I used to solder. Of course, you can use highly concentrated alcohol solutions and that will work. And basically I'm going to clean the connector side a little bit and the buttons over here a little bit, because usually that's pretty much why they don't work, because they are not clean in this board that has suffered a lot of tests, and that's pretty much why. So we'll just get this, yeah, this one isopropyl alcohol. Alright. So cleaning is pretty straightforward. What I do is I clean this this socket, the connector of the ribbon. Why? Because the way I solder it, I use a lot of flux, and flux tend to get into everywhere, and it's nasty, and it's not good, definitely. So I'm just cleaning this a bit. A bit of rust or flux leftover appear on this. You don't want to do too much pressure, otherwise the how this called the well basically the material this is made of will start degrading and perhaps getting on the board. But yeah, basically I just sneak it a little bit over here, and what I tend to do is I put a bit on the flex cable as well and just plug it and unplug it. So just a little bit over here, unplug it and unplug it a couple of times, and then dry everything. So yeah, that should work. Now I just get a dry one and dry this a bit. The buttons are what worry me the most, because they were just working perfectly a couple hours ago, and because they are a bit dirty, they sometimes stop working and they are just really bit nasty, but they are good. Now no much flux left. That should be good. So I'm just going to plug everything here, make sure the flex cable is actually dry. You don't want any alcohol. The best way to solder the 40-pin connector was to use water through flux. Yes, that would be good. Is it possible to put the top cover on with this mod? If you mean the top screen, like using it, no, currently with this mod you can do it. But if you mean just having the top screen, even though the screen cannot be seen, yes, you can do it. Of course, you're going to... the DS has... Where is it? This part of the DS, which is basically... has some little hole here where the flex cable go. So you can get the flex out of here, or you can just... you can even disassemble the top screen and remove it, if that's what you mean. I mean the top shell with the buttons. This mod. I don't understand exactly what you're asking. Top cover with this mod. Yes, if you mean reassemble the DS, of course, you can put the top shell. I don't know if that's what you're asking, but Rotronix says it's possible, and as far as I'm concerned, he has built one yet, so yeah, let's say yes. So, okay. Usually with these ribbon cables, you will notice when they fit properly. And just make sure it's aligned, which I may review a couple of times until I get it properly. But once you place the lock on the ribbon cable, it's good to go. So I'm just going to plug it. And we're ready. Yep. Hello there, I'm 2Extra. Okay, so what I want to test now that we've cleaned the board a little bit is we're going to test here on the DS that the buttons work and the two screen mode work. Because basically you can play games. Which game do we have here? Okay, I have Pokemon Black. Well, it will work. I will have preferred Spectrops, but this will work. So I'll just plug the DS and let's see what is going on here. Okay, so it's working, but I don't know if you can appreciate it. Well, usually the buttons work without plugging the... without turning on the board, so that's really good. But I think you can see it now. You can see that there are two screens actually showing here. There's the main menu, and there's the top screen showing overlaid on the bottom screen, right? So, basically, what do the buttons on the boards do? This one, the S1, the one that is closer to me, basically swaps the screen that is being shown on the TV with the one being shown on the bottom screen. And the other ones are used to toggle this mode, how can we call it? Overlay mode, for example, yeah? I think that can work. So I don't really know if you can appreciate it. Yeah, that can be seen there, but there's two screens in one. So if I press the button, okay, do you see that? Now the top screen is being shown here on the left corner, on the bottom left corner. So if I press it again, I will move it to, I've pressed two times, sorry. So total overlay, left overlay, right overlay, no overlay, okay? Also you can, when you're in overlay mode, you can basically just change the, how would I call this, the transparency? Yeah, the transparency, you can change it. That's the right word. So this is actually excellent because with a broken DS, you can actually play DS games. It's not the same, of course, but you can have both screens here. And yeah, opacity will be the right word. Yeah, transparency, opacity, yeah. And are those modes hard-coded? Yes, they are hard-coded, not by us, but this is features that are on the Nintendo DS processor. So basically, we cannot reprogram them, mostly because they are not software. They are likely hardware. They are programming hardware. So if you are, you know what VHDL is, logic design. So basically, we believe that's like that on the SOC. System on chip, by the way. Okay, so this is working, and opacity works quite well. So does. Let's boot a game so I can show you the mode I'm booting with opacity set on. But can you see that that's the Nintendo logo that would appear on the top of screen, and the credits now appearing on the left side of the console. So you could basically play like this with only one screen. Let me get the button rubber so I can press the buttons. These are the, yeah, I think the A buttons will work. This is basically from the DS. I'm just temporarily putting it here. Yes, the TV out board, there's actually a case that a person has designed and we are evaluating it. Well, now you can see it, but it's playing the Pokemon Black intro that will usually play on the top screen here. So I'm just going to skip it. Okay, the same intro again. And there we go, so we can fully play Pokemon with only one screen. This is excellent. Now, yeah, let's boot my game with how many hours of play do I have here? In 106 hours of play, that's really nice. I'm not sure what it's asking. Yeah, activate the communication. Okay, I don't care. And let's try the total overlay mode. Oh, I miss these games. So now we are on partial overlay, but let's just go to total overlay mode. Am I pressing the correct button? No, I'm not pressing the correct button. Okay, so let's increase the opacity. Okay, so now we're basically, I think you cannot appreciate it very well, but on my side it looks incredible. It almost looks as if I had the, how do I say, the top screen on the bottom screen, and, well, yeah, this cannot be seen very well, but I'm basically playing Pokemon right now, so I'm getting out of the Pokemon Center and so on. These modes are tied to the TV output, not to the hardware side, so they are not tied to this board per se, but they are tied to the firmware, so you of course need the custom firmware for them to work. But as you can see, as you've seen before, it's very easy to install. I don't know if we have people here who have joined recently, so if you have joined recently, by the way, follow the channel, and yeah, we've shown how to install the custom firmware pretty easy and very straightforward. So, okay, this works. I think we're going to give it another try on the TV to swap the screens. Otherwise, I will send you to Nico's video where he plays a lot of games on his TV, and that's pretty much it. There's another couple of things I would like to talk about. For example, you ask if this is tied to the TV output. There's a person that has shown, like we did in our initial test, that you can actually just, for example, solder some buttons to the board if you are able to figure the exact bias on this part, which, well, they are on the schematics we have on GitHub, but anyways. So yeah, it's possible to do it for a macro mode just to have this screen swapping mode. But either way, we are working on all the solutions that we'll show perhaps later. We'll talk about them. Let's give it a final try on the TV and see if our games work. This button works. I'm going to just clean it a final time. I don't want to leave that in the back burner. So let's just clean it a little bit. I could test it with the multimeter, but I know it's going to work because it always does when I test it. And then it just mysteriously doesn't want to be pressed correctly, so it's either the flex or whatever. Okay, let's go to the TV side again, and let's make a final try.
All right, here we are. Let's do the final test. Let's try to plug this, plug the white one, plug the red one, and we're good to go. I'm actually going to move the cable a little bit. Just don't want it to be hanging on here. So yeah, let's do the trick pretty much. usually don't want the flex to go too hard, but okay, this is turned off. I will just turn on and let's go to the TV side. There we go. Okay, these are the live streaming problems. Your button, your stupid button won't work. The other opacity and stuff is working perfectly on the bottom screen as we saw earlier. So that's no big deal. But let's try to make the button work. I think I just need to resolder it a bit, but I don't know if you wanna see me do that live. I could try, but because we have time, I will probably try to do it either way. Let's just, yeah, opacity and so on works fine. But for some reason, right now my button doesn't want to work, which we're going to quick real fast. We're going to do a fix for this. Usually you won't have these problems. In fact, we have soldered many boards now, and this is the only board that has this problem. So
unfortunately, this had to appear just when we're going live. Let's see. All right. Let's unplug this always. And let's just put the DS apart. Let's just turn on the soldering. Let's get some soldering tape or seat. It's over here, okay. And we just need to wait for this to heat up. So I'm just going to manually fix it, but that's pretty much the deal. I tried to upload a pull request on your GitHub for revised PCB. Triple file is disabled. We will check it, but this will be able to do a pull request. Unless for some weird reason, the organization on GitHub is not well configured, but it's okay. So, okay, let's just do this real quick. Thanks everyone that's following the Twitch channel. We'll probably talk more about other projects that we have. If there's good reception, maybe instead of just releasing them at the given moment without previous announce. So yeah, that's pretty hot. I will just fix this real quick. The button, I don't know if you can see it, but it's slightly moved to one side. So that's mostly the issue. Shouldn't be too difficult to fix. So just going to, basically what I'm going to do is put more soldering tin, because I think it doesn't make contact or something. If that doesn't work, don't worry, as I said, this is just because we're doing live stream. And you know, when you do a streaming, everything goes wrong. That's like a Moore's law or something. And this just happened to us. So yeah, I think this should be good enough. Well, I would have never imagined that I would be live soldering today, but we are. So, all right. Okay, that should be good. Let's just do a final test on the TV. And let me just clean this a little bit. No big deal. Yeah, this should be much better. It's not perfect, so I'm not really sure it's going to work, but we don't lose anything for trying. What I will do is replace this button after, and pretty much it. Okay, let's see that the it's working here. We plug it again. So, as Rotronix mentioned, everything is on the GitHub page in case someone hasn't yet seen it. On the GitHub repository, actually, to be precise, to be accurate. Just like this. Okay. So opacity works. But this button doesn't seem to truly work. Which, let's check something real quick. All right. So as you can see, mostly the only issue this may have is the flex cable, which is a nightmare sometimes, for me at least, though this board is giving me the most nightmares. All the boards are usually quite good to go. You just plug them, and they work, and that's pretty much how we've done with others. These are 101, I have 102 over here boards, and they just work the same. Let's just plug the TV out. All right. If you don't have a resistor mod, then what can happen is that your TV may just, well, not your TV, your DS may shut down if you remove it, because of course it doesn't detect the how's it called? Ah, good. Okay, let's go to the TV and do a final test, but I'm not confident this one is going to work. The button, I mean, of course. So yeah, then we'll discuss the research and all the stuff you are mentioning here, and that's pretty interesting. We can maybe talk about some more things we are trying with these current boards and the current I mean, using these boards as a prototyping board, because you can just plug the flex cable, and these boards have test pins. So basically, once you have plugged them into the flex cable, you don't need to solder into the DS, because you now can solder here or can do your test with the signals from here. So up for a final test, I don't know what I have just done here. I will leave it plugged, but I mostly think I'm rushing too much this and not plugging them properly. I don't know. Or maybe my hands are too big or something. Who knows? But yeah. So, oh, hold up. I'm gonna reverse the ribbon cable, because typically one of the ribbon cable sides has some closer white line to the, do you see that white line over there? Okay, one of the sides has the white line closer to the actual pins over here. So one of these sides will be covered up by this flip thing, by this lock that locks the ribbon cable. So just to be really meticulous, going to do a last cleanup, and we'll be ready to do a final test, and then we'll talk about those future plans, custom firmware, and we'll release the custom firmware as soon as this finishes, so you can just install it and test it and whatever you want. I'm sure Rotronics, you can give your feedback on the custom firmware as far as you get it. Yeah, I know, because I saw your pictures on Twitter and you had that ready, so yeah, pretty much it. Let's clean this a little bit with care. Let's plug it a couple times. Ah, Moore's Law, always when you stream, everything fails. All right, this one seems to be really good right now. And this one, hopefully, is well. Okay, that click means it's good. Hello, Varial, how's it going? We're now modding some consoles. Let's get to the final TV test. And if we don't succeed, we'll try it another day, just to record some gameplay on the TV and show how the games on full and a big TV like the one I have work, because it's really good to play. Do you have an idea of... Okay, Mr. Starfire, I know who you are. Okay, let's get down to business and let's go to the TV.
All right, so we should be good to go. Can you hear me? Yes, yes, okay, this is working perfectly, just checking. I don't like that this is moving too much on with this larger flex, so I'm going to... Let me just put this here. All right, that should be much more stable. I'm going to put the spectroscopes to see if it gives me some kind of lag. And the button has been fixed. And let's give it a try. Okay, so the board is turned off. Let's turn it on. Okay, so we have spectrums over there. And the mother button doesn't like to work. See my head, I could actually just short the temporal LEDs and do the swap manually, because it had to fail just on the day we are doing live streaming. All right, so I think we're not going to spend much more time just trying to fix a button that doesn't work, because that's kind of pointless for the purpose of the video. The important part is seeing how to install it, how to disassemble the DS and get to the ribbon cable. So we're going to do now the kind of opposite process a bit. And let's talk about the future versions and research and all these subjects. So yeah, thanks to this board for not working the only day we are live streaming. Okay, well, at least everything else is working fine. Opacity, screen swapping is working. I will just check it and perhaps do another stream some other day with playing games or something like that. All right, good to go. Well, you've seen that this works pretty well. This is real. This is no hoax. You have all the source. You have all the BOM files, schematics, and everything over there. So yeah, pretty much all you need to make your own boards. Everything is public. We got schematics, PCB files to directly manufacture them. You don't need to even understand them in case you don't want. And yep, let's go back and see what we can do over there.
Right. It could be why I didn't show the PCB. Yes, basically is what I was thinking about doing. My idea was to just remove the button, and I think I could do it right now with the soldering tip if you really want to see it in action. Okay, let's do that. Let's check with the multimeter first to see if we haven't broken anything. So basically all we need to do is... Okay, this works. So we get this side of the button and we get pin number. It's this one, all right. It's quite small, so I'm trying to... Oh, okay, there we go. Yeah, as you can see, the connection from the bottom to the flex cable is working. Where is it? I've lost it. Okay. Yeah, that works. So it's basically the stupid button that I decided to break in the best moment. Just plug this in and try to remove it. So as some people mentioned, we have, I think, one board over Tindy. That's 1v2. We have all the schematics and stuff on GitHub, which should be all you really need to be fair. And everything is open. However, a step from our custom firmware, which I'm going to repeat because I said this at the beginning, but we cannot release directly the custom firmware binary. Why? Because it's copyrighted by Nintendo, because it contains assets and code directly from original and modified from Nintendo. So that's no good. We cannot publish that directly, But basically what we're going to do is show you how to install a base firmware. What is the link to your Tindy? That's on the Lost Nintendo History account, if on Twitter, if I'm not mistaken. So let's repeat this. Pretty much that's what will do the trick. What are we saying? Yeah, we will basically leave the a way to install a base firmware. So with that base firmware, you can then patch it and get all these working features. We're working on even more features, additional stuff, like perhaps this is not sure to be to happen. We know we'll just finish or we'll leave it like this. But basically, we wanted to add support for saving configuration, like which screen you want by default on to appear when you boot with the chip installed. So perhaps storing that on the flash or stuff like that. I'm not using enough solder here. No, we don't have only fans link, unless you guys are really interested into seeing boards and chips and buttons, in which case, who knows. All right, we got rid of the button, more or less. Just need to remove this sheet over here, which was left. This has gave us so much problems, like the smallest and most stupid components. Let's put a bit more wire. I'm just doing the worst soldering I've done ever. Never really soldered in a rush, which is not good, but I guess you can all watch how I murder this button and just get away with it because it's completely legal. So yeah, but actually fixing these boards, it's really simple, as you've been able to see here, so no big deal. Just remove this. Okay, we should be good to go. I'm going to put a little bit more of tin here. Yeah, there we go. And over there. And we should be good to go. I'm not going to short them. It shows you and shipped to the US. Yeah, remove that because it was quite problematic. Because we don't really have trusty way of shipping, you know, because of COVID-19, it has gone nuts. Shippings are taking too long to arrive, and well, I really didn't want to have those problems, but you should be able to find resellers over there, I guess. But I'll check into that. You could just get the Euro 5 machines. Yeah, that's what it costed, $23, the initial price I put, but turns out it was much more expensive, at least from Spain, which is where I shipped from. So it actually was like the cheapest thing was like 30 euros, I guess, which is like $35. So yeah, I removed it because of that. And anyways, this should be good to go. I'm just going to check again. Let's see. Connection should be still good. So we got this one over here. Right. And we should be kinda able to to short it very easily with whatever. I will just bring all the conductive stuff that I got here, the screwdriver, the tinfoil. Something will work. Okay, let's go for the final test. Button remove, we'll just try like that. We're going to do a first test on the DS, unless Nico wants to stop me because it's going to explode or something, but I think it's completely fine. I just massacre this board a little bit. But as I said, this is actually a test board. It's not even the last version that you can get from the GitHub. It's a previous just versing minor fixes, so no big deal. Turn it off. And there we go. Right. So let me get. No, it won't. This won't work. Okay, it works. It works. Yeah, the streaming is not completely ruined. It works. It's just a stupid button. See my head. Okay, let's see if you can. Okay, can you see that? So basically, we're swapping the top screen with the bottom screen. Now the bottom screen will be outputting to the top screen. I just swap in there. Who needs buttons when you have tinfoil? Let's go. Let's go, baby. Now let's test this on the TV and play a little bit for a minute or two. Meanwhile, I suggest if you want, you can subscribe to the channel. We'll be posting more stuff, not only TV out project, but future projects that, well, we can give much more details right now. But we have some other stuff going on, both preservation stuff for the DS, mods and that sort of stuff. So let's go to the TV and finally, for the final time, let's make this work and play.
All right, so final test, the moment of truth. This is what we've all been waiting for, swapping the TV screen that has took us so much time. But anyways, I think it's a good moment to say thank you for watching and staying, and let's see what we can get here. So my TV, my DS is plugged, is turned on. We'll just turn this on. Okay, so we have perfect, crystal clear, video signal. This just swap. There we go. Okay, we got bottom screen on the top screen, so you see, you can just switch, and I'm going to put you the spectrum of intro because it's amazing. By the way, when you have the top screen of the bottom screen, which you cannot really see now, but I will show you. Yeah, okay, let's show you with this camera. So basically, the other screen is here, but the touch screen is still the one that is on the TV. So if I touch here, I will actually boot the game. Let's see it. There we go. So this works. Let's swap the screen again. There we go. So that's pretty much all that is to the TV out project for now. Now, this is how it works. You can just use the other stuff that was shown previously. I will just boot the game. Previously, I will slow down there. We'll reduce the volume. Okay, so the good thing is if you're playing like this, you have the top screen, you can be looking at the bottom screen, or you can swap. And there we go, we have Rallin over there. And come on, Rallin, why don't you move? There we go. Never remember the controls of this game, but no big deal. So yeah, you can play perfectly, and whenever you need to swap the screen, just press the button, which again, I will show you now when we go back to the lab, the different cases. Well, I think Nico can, if you can pass the link on Twitch from this 3D printable case for the TV out, that will be nice. And all right, let's swap the screen again so you can see, basically. There we go, bottom screen. I don't know if these buttons are going to work right now because I just messed so much with them. Yeah, they work. Anyways, screen shopping. You can just play whatever you want. Let's try Pokemon just because it's really great too, or Mario Kart or whatever. And well, I haven't brought any GBA card right now with me, though I have, but they are not here. So I think I'm not going to test that, but it should work pretty much without problem. Just try to swap the screen. Okay. Just there we go. Oh, all right. I'm really dumb because the cutscene is on the other screen, so I will just swap it. There we go. We got Game Freak. Good old Game Freak. Not the greedy people they are now. Gonna skip this and get straight to the game. Okay, so I have played 198 hours. Not bad. Okay, okay, okay. Yeah, you can tell I like this game back in the day, and now, of course. Yeah. So, for example, this is the top screen. Now we will have the bottom screen, which is telling me to activate communication and stuff. Not going to do it. So let's just go straight into the game. Oh gosh, this looks really nice to play on TV. In fact, oh man, this is amazing. Looks really good. I haven't tried Pokemon. I have tried a lot of other games like Spectrops, Mario Kart, FIFA. For some reason, I have FIFA for the DS. Don't ask. And yep, they work fine. And Pokemon looks amazing. This is the bottom screen again. I could show you the how they're called, the opacity and that stuff we saw earlier. That works on the bottom screen, the DS that I have here. So the touch screen, of course, works perfectly. If I were able, yeah, have using that, I'm clicking on the touch screen, but it's being shown on the TV, so pretty good. Okay, I don't have Wi-Fi enablers. No, I don't have it configured, actually, so I'm not going to configure it. I think I'm just too lazy, not going to do that right now. Let's do a final swap. And there we go. This is it. The quality is actually really good, considering Nintendo DS came out in 2006. This is the maximum quality you can get. The TV out gives you the most, the highest quality, which is a full 10 bits for video output. And yeah, that's pretty much all that to play in. Now we'll get to finally reassembling and all that stuff. And yep, let's get to do that, unless you want to see the other games. I have Mario Kart over here, but yeah, no plans on playing right now, truly. So I have, as I said, every card work. Important, flash cards work as well. So if you have your old R4, you can play with that. In fact, even if it's patched, because this custom firmware bypasses all the DRM checks. So and you can boot old flash cards as long as you have the correct files on the micro SD card. And that's good. That's good to know. Let's, I'm not going to save because I have already saved. But you can see the whole bottom screen looks even better for some reason. It's much more clear. Looking really nice. Do we have you? We have the. Okay, I'm sorry, but I'm now being filled with some nostalgia, and you know, yeah, all reliable. Okay, pretty much a test on the TV. You see, it works really well, and let's get to finish the installation step.
All right. Yeah, I know you want the firmware, Rotronics. don't worry. As soon as it's ready, it's basically we could publish it right now with just one click of our mouses. But we want to talk really about it so people know what they are flashing into their DSs. And that's most that covers most of the usage part, as you've seen the what each of the button does. The board is really reliable. We have built a lot of them, and only this one broke, which is a shame, but shame ahead. Okay, let's get to building everything back again. I'm going to leave this. What I'm going to do is not place the out button, because then the flex goes right there, and we got it. But what you can do, which is the best trick. Okay, so I have here this is the R button. So with the L button, you can just cut it a little bit over here, and the ribbon cable will just go out. The button will work perfectly, and you will get your whole shell. No need to break it, no need to do anything weird. You can, of course, fit it in other ways, but I'm not going to get really into deep. I'm not going to get deep into that, because that's something I haven't played that much. I've tried a couple ways. The flex ribbons itself are quite resistant. You can turn them, you can of course flex them, as long as you don't bend them from past the point of no return, it should be good. So where do we start? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to remove the battery. I'm going to do the opposite process. So basically, we'll just remove it. There we go. I lost the button rubbers on the way. I'm just going to put them in their original place, which is the top shell. And this one goes here with the square, and this one goes here. And let's leave this apart again for a moment over here. Should be good. All right. Now, yes, we need to quit the board from here. We're going to do the opposite process to assemble it. So we start with this case to assemble it. All we need to do is place it like here. There we go. Make sure you fit the holes, but this is usually quite easy. Make sure to have your firmware chip connected, otherwise the screen will be blank, or actually black. Don't dare to lower the music, Dorito said on the while playing Pokemon, for sure. Alright, what is left? Yeah, now we need the screwdriver. We're just going to, well, actually let's put first the buttons. So we have the R button, which as you can see goes here. If I'm not mistaken, this is the L button, the one I'm not going to place, okay, for this time, just because I'm lazy to modify it, and I disassembled the DS too much to actually solder, and I really wanna break it for now, but I will do it eventually. And if you have this chip, actually dirt cheap cases on AliExpress that you can buy, and what am I doing? Hold up. Yes, this is all right. R button. Yeah, it works. It's very easy to assemble again. All we need is now these fine screws, Phillips screws again. This is the opposite process we did before. If there's interest, I will show later, perhaps with a button here, but for simplicity now I will not do it. I will just place this over here. And this will make sure the DS is now, make sure the board is kinda stable. You know, stability is important, you know the meme. And okay, we can basically proceed to put this again. As I said, I haven't unplugged the bottom board because I don't want to plug it again. It's such a big deal. Okay, important when you reassemble the case, make sure the sliders for the volume and for the power button are in the same place that they are here. Otherwise, the case won't fit, and when you actually fit it, the buttons won't work. No big deal again, but let's just make sure. Again, it fits perfectly. As you can see, I'm leaving this here, where you can just place the button. Alright, so there we go. Now all is left, just put the final screws. There are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6, 7 screws left. And now there's 6 left. Stability is important, yeah. Nintendo firmware, it's important because the DS Lite doesn't have firmware updating capability, so make sure your DS is stable. You need that. Well, you're actually updating it with our custom firmware, which adds all these features that were removed for some reason. We actually have one theory about what could have happened for these to be left over. Do you want to know about it? Make sure that it is charging or it will be brick. No matter. Well, if you mean when flashing the firmware, yes, of course. If your battery dies just when you are flashing, yeah, it will die. Yeah, as Strand is saying, I told the stability thing because of the meme. But it's even memeier because the DS doesn't have firmware updates. At least not in the traditional sense that modern consoles do. But yeah, for everyone listening who is not knowing of the meme, basically when Nintendo patches a vulnerability in their firmwares in consoles, so for example the Switch or whatever, and they don't change anything else, they don't put in the chain log, yeah, we have patched a vulnerability, now they say stability updates, we have improved your stability. And there's only one screw left. I don't know why it is taking me so much to put them, but anyways. Don't forget this screw, this is the easiest one to forget. And there we go, we just need to put this. I'm going to assemble it in full. Now I'm going to say something important about booting the factory mode. So yeah, I'm going to completely assemble it. So I'm going to leave it like that. So, there we go. Okay, it's done. I will place... I don't have games here. I have some crappy game for the DS. So, of course, test that it works after installing. And it does. Don't worry if... when on the factory settings thing, the board doesn't work. Because it's meant not to work. Okay, when it's on factory reset, it's running another branch of code different than the traditional or the retail branch of code that the path that it follows that we have patched. So at this point, well, I cannot do it, but anyways, you only have to do this once when you remove the battery. Just put your nickname, I'm going to do it like this so you can see your color. No big deal again. The year. Yes, it has one of those triangle screws. They are called rewind or something like that. I'm not sure, but yeah, it has some of them. It was using one of those screws. Yeah. Those prototypes. I've seen the pictures. Okay, this is done. Reset it, and now it works. So if I, if now I just do this, okay, you see the screen changes, top, bottom, wait, top, bottom, okay. So it works. Everything else works as well. Shit, I just turned down the DS. What is going on? Oh, okay, I changed the brightness. This is no big deal, but it's basically because of the resistor I have put. So basically now the DS, have you seen that I have... No, I didn't blow the fuse. If I had blown the fuse, when this wouldn't boot at all. So what is happening right now is that I'm turning it on, and you see I set the brightness to a lower level. So basically what happens is the board works fine, but have you seen that I had a resistor installed inside my DS? Well, that resistor is not good because I didn't have the proper resistor, which is like 1K if I recall correctly, and mine is 10K. So it's not the proper one, but I just installed it because I didn't really care about it. So no big deal again, but it's probably not going to boot. Yeah, I just need to change the resistor because otherwise it won't boot. But yeah, that's pretty much all to the DS. As you have seen, the screen changes, the board works, the mode is perfectly working. What is left to do? Release the firmware. Important. There are four steps to install the firmware. So what you're going to do is install FlashMe, a version that we're going to tell you. It's FlashMe V8. How was it called? V8 and A, I think it's the version. Now, then you are going to run a firmware on your DS that is going to just dump again that firmware that you have just installed. And you are finally going to run the patcher and flash it again. And that's pretty much it. So I think we can release it by now. If Nico, you are over there, feel free to push the release button. Press it really hard, and that's pretty much it regarding the custom firmware and the board. So, what else is to talk? I think someone asked about why was this existing on the DS Lite. So we have one theory. This theory is actually made by not made, but Gearcom is the one who came up with this because he's been on the DS system for much longer than us, or at least than me. Again, he's the programmer of GBA Runner, the hypervisor for the DS Lite and the DSi, as well as other cool stuff. Like, for example, NTR G-Drag couldn't work without his previous work because he had code for decompressing games, extracting their code, etc., etc. So that's the important work that has led us to being able to do this. Okay, so what's the theory, if you want to know? Basically, someone mentioned the Switch prototypes, right? If I'm not mistaken, let me check it out. The Switch prototypes. Yeah, so Nintendo has a history of making prototypes for the consoles, both the dev kits, which in a sense the earlier dev kits are kind of prototypes, you could say. I'm not seeing who told the thing about the Switch, but yeah, basically Nintendo plays a lot with prototypes. So at some point in the design of the DS Lite, so the DS FAT was already published, released, and they were designing the DS Lite, we believe they used the boards, like the actual motherboards, like protoboards. So the same way you will use an Arduino, for example, to make prototypes and stuff like that. So they will probably have that feature, and they will get TV output, maybe to test something and stuff like that. Important to mention is that this is not related to dev kits at all. The hardware that makes this work inside the DS, it's not the same that is on the dev kits. Dev kits use a combination of FPGAs and some other converters. So it's like a huge board. There are pictures if you look on Google, so basically like huge boards that convert the proprietary signal format of the LCD whatever they had, which was, I don't know, VGA or RCA. I don't remember. I don't have a Nintendo DS dev kit, so I don't really know. But if Gergon has played with them, I've seen them, we've messed with them, and yeah, that's basically what they have inside. So, no total correlation. Nitro dev kit, but it was the one that did not display to TV. All right, that's really nice. If I'm not mistaken, there are three types of Nitro dev kits. Not completely sure, but there's the one that has a display, no display, and display but with Wi-Fi or at least wireless connection of some sort. And yeah, those were probably made at the same time that this was made, or perhaps even earlier, because the DS Lite dev kits are just an improvement over DS FAT dev kits, as far as I'm concerned. And also, the dev kits were manufactured by another totally different company, which was called, it had a weird name, Imagine something, something among those lines. So yeah, that's pretty much it to the dev kits. The history about this is that, yeah, we were reversing the hardware. You can see Nico profiles schematics of the reverse engineering on the board, and pretty much it. This took us like, we are in March, so let's say 3.5 months. What we did first was we just captured with a signal analyzer, sniper, okay, like CLI logic or the cheaper ones. Those you can buy in AliExpress, for example. And we were getting the first signals, sending them to PC, saving them on a file, and then manually, not manually, but with a software, we were decoding them to PAL or to NTCC. And yeah, then we moved to a simple DAC, DAC, which is a resistor ladder, a typical, R2R DAC. That is the earliest prototype. Props to Nico because he made that one. It was amazing. The first time we saw it live on the TV, I don't remember pretty much if Nico did it have 10 bits at the time. I don't think so, because with an R2R DAC you cannot have the full bytes because of voltage reasons and impedance, if I'm not mistaken. So yeah, basically those prototypes were using just 5 bits of video signal, so the quality was worse, but the full board uses the final board, this one uses the but first prototype 5 bits, I knew it. I didn't know if it was 5 or 6. I think with 6 an R2R doesn't work. Am I right, Nico? I think with 6 bits is the voltage levels or something along those lines wasn't enough. So yeah, basically, but this one, because it uses the commercial DAC, DLC, this Max can handle perfectly 10 bits, so yeah, pretty much it. So it's an amplifier, the DAC, and this socket is the hardest thing to really solder, actually. So that would be it. Feel free to ask any questions now. If you'd like this project, consider perhaps following the channel. Yes, there is one board, though we haven't had fully time to test it, but we'll get to it eventually as soon as possible. We wanted to release the custom firmware first. This was the top number one priority, releasing the custom firmware, and yeah, after that I think we will investigate other revisions and possibilities, but pretty much it. That's the thing for today, releasing custom firmware. You can get the steps by now, I guess. And that's pretty much it. Installing FlashMe, that exact version with the hash we have put in the page. Install it on the DS, then dump the firmware again with a homebrew that you can run from any flash card. Then extract that dump, put it into the PC, run our patcher, which is basically an IPS patch, and that's going to patch your firmware with all our modifications, and then you can just reflash it like I've done at the beginning. When this is, when this streaming ends, you can go and watch it again. I will download it and upload it somewhere else. It was never a retail feature. Yes, it was never a... Well, it's a retail feature because it's in all retail consoles, but it was not planned. Well, we don't know if it was planned to use it. So can this be run without using 12 minutes? Yes, of course. I guess you have come now. During all the video, I haven't used 12 menu at all. I have just used the standard menu of the DS Lite. 12 menu was only needed in the before we released the custom firmware. Now we have embedded all those features into the custom firmware. So once you boot it, you get TV output directly. So yes, no 12 menu requirement anymore. But if you want to keep using it, you can use it in case you find it, I don't know, more fancy or whatever. Twilight menu is nice because you can be playing a game and go back to the menu without shutting down the console. So that's a really great advantage, and props to Rocket Drops for developing Twilight menu for final users. Yeah, again, we are not really sure. Did they plan it for to be in retail, or they were just using the boards as proto boards like Arduinos and they left that door in the sock? So yeah, the AK2i says the same thing. Yep, that's good. Some, those are the most expensive flash cards that you can get, if I'm not mistaken, but again, any cheap one will work. And LRB for resetting the flash card. Yes, but not all of them have it, I guess. But yes, AK2i has it. So I have over here, just to show you the differences between, it's very minor differences. I don't know if you're going to be able to watch it, but this is a V12 board. This is the one that you will get. And this is the 1v1 board that I've been using the board, but it's completely the same. The usage is the same. The buttons are in the same location, switches, everything. So yeah, this one is slightly thinner than the other one. I don't know if you can appreciate it. Yeah, I think so. I think it can be seen. Yeah, no big deal. So both are very good. Nico did an excellent design. So nothing to say about the boards anymore. I think all that need to be said has been said. PSP, yeah, DS Lite was a very weird console. By the way, if anyone is interested, yesterday someone managed to dump the bootloader from the DSi, the ARM7 bootloader, which hadn't been dumped before. And that's really good. We had actually attempted to dump it before, well, I guess I can say this policy. We had tried to do it at some point. Well, I have tried, though I didn't manage to. I didn't have the proper setup to do it. I lacked some skills on fault injection, which I'm not working on it. And yeah, to be honest, fault injection is an amazing technique. It's almost like magic, but easy magic. So if you want to learn more about hacking consoles and stuff, perhaps check on that. And well, there isn't much more to say unless you wanna ask questions, which we'll answer gladly. And yep, that's pretty much it for today's streaming of installation of the TV out board. This is how it looks. Perhaps it looks, it happened to me the first time I saw the renders, it looks big, but it's not big. It's actually quite small, quite compact board. The most compact it could be. So yeah, in case you want to have not to have to post some suggestions or improvements, but I think we'll consider all that you've said today, like having them just for GBA macro and stuff like that. So today we've been tinkering a bit with it. You've seen how this works, and that's pretty much it. Feel free now to ask any question. It's the moment. Sure, when is the uncovered? I mean, yeah, component superior to composite. Okay. Can everybody do it in their homes? I don't think so. I can't. I wouldn't be able to now connect my TV to IPVPR. And, well, to be honest, in Spain, it's, how is this called? Component is still quite common. Like, most TVs have it, a converter for it. But though HDMI is the standard, so that's pretty much the reason. Also, it was pretty easy to convert it to component, because that's how it's almost encoded in the bit output. So it's 10 bits, and we got the conversions are really easy to composite. We were familiar with the sorry, I'm not showing it on the screen. We were familiar with the with a component. We have it on our TVs. We could test it, and I guess that's pretty much the reason. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Maybe Nico wants to add something, but that's basically what we were discussing, how to design it. No more. Yeah, I think that's pretty much it. The coding, but it becomes really expensive. Okay. Yes. Yes, this is the most economical solution. The problem with other commercial stuff, well, I believe the only similar thing commercial is it's the DSFAT capture card, which I don't even know if it's still being sold, but it's only for DSFAT. It's really bulky hardware inside the DSFAT. This is cheap. This works on any DS Lite. And yeah, Loopy. Never has it. Yes, exactly. I think he made some boards like 10 years ago, and that's pretty much it. Which, by the way, that's an amazing mod, but I don't personally know Loopy or the mod, but to what I see. And Katsuki got arrested, I think. I don't know who's Katsukiti, but got arrested, okay. What will be the price of a finished board? Well, that depends. 3DS capture card, so no more 3DS capture card. Well, just out of curiosity, why did he, or yeah, he got arrested? If we can ask. I don't know the story. I don't even know who Katsuki is, but yeah, why not? Because 3DS capture card is a totally white area stuff. I mean, it's not, it's legal. The same way this is completely legal. This doesn't contain at all any copyrighted content, nor does any of the resources in our GitHub. This is purely open hardware, and to which the extent that we can open software. So yeah, mostly that's pretty much it. And what will be the price? I haven't answered. That really depends. If you're asking me directly, well, it depends on where you're located because of shipping and stuff. But the boards itself aren't expensive. Like, say the boards. The DAC, the DAC is the most expensive component. I can look up how much it cost in Mouser. Well, I think that's on the BOM. Well, it may be, I'm not completely sure, but yeah, that's the most expensive component. And then it depends on if you have someone soldered for you, or you do it in your home. Cost of a single board is 120, what? I'm not saying it's not that expensive, but no. It's not that expensive. I mean, if you're able to say solder it yourself, it can be quite more cheaper. No, you don't need to actually order hundreds of them. You can have smaller stocks from 5 to 10 units, and they are not that expensive at all. In fact, like, not trying to not appreciate other people's work, but if someone asks you for more than 100, yes, basically it's what Nico says. If you do it yourself, the price of 5 PCB is 100. Well, of course, if you're talking about 5 PCBs, Completely sold, yes. Then 100, that could be, not for a single board, sorry. If you meant one board, no, of course one board won't cost you 100. It should cost you less than 100. So basically, yeah, if you buy more, yes, minimum is 5, yeah, that's for, but I guess Strand Zero, is that how I pronounce it? It's okay, yeah. Meant for one single board, so yeah, $50, €50 should be a fair price. But though it could vary depending on if you have someone solder it for you or assemble it, where do you buy the components? For example, Mauser is typically expensive, but it's the best place to buy the components. So yes, I cannot give you an exact price, but if you assemble it yourself, like Nico is saying, then $50 is perhaps what could cost you. It could cost you less if, say, you just go on board. I hope it's not expensive. Yes, of Farnell has them. That's right. When it gets to the console sides, yeah, we can, unfortunately, we cannot control that much on that. But as we said, it should not be too expensive. And if it's too expensive, you can probably find someone who sells them at a lower price. Okay, so keep that in mind if you buy any field board from someone else that it's not us or that it's not say sponsored. We don't sponsor anyone, as I said, open hardware, the software is public, so yeah, pretty much. Yeah, fully assembled board, of course. By the way, I think I didn't mention it, but the custom firmware has something really interesting, which is it does have how is this called? It has recovery features. I hope they get priced down to, however. Well, yeah, basically, if you for some reason, after installing the firmware, the custom firmware, want to go back to stock or whatever, you can do it with no problem. The custom firmware includes recovery, and it's basically the thing you saw in the video. You got R button, A, B, no, sorry, start select, A, B, if I'm not mistaken. I don't remember it, but yeah, that was it, start select, B and A. And you can just boot directly into the card, so you can use a flash card or whatever you got lying around to fix it. And if you have two DS Lights, even better, because you can just swap the you can just swap the, what's this called, the firmware chip, and use the working DS with a working firmware chip to recover the other. So basically, Nintendo DS Lite is unbreakable as long as you don't destroy the hardware, you know. So it's pretty much yeah, unbreakable. You can just move it over there. Yeah, basically the L button. Don't worry about cutting the a little crease like Retronic says, because once you do that, it's, let me see if I can show you this. Okay, do you see this small edge that is over here? You can just cut a little bit so the ribbon passes over there and it works flawlessly, but I'm not going to do it right now. I do have another case which has that done, and the best thing is that it's unnoticeable once you look at the buttons, so good to know, isn't it? So yeah, pretty much it. Working DS, and there's nothing else. It's going to be 2 hours of streaming right now, so fire your final questions. Follow the channel if you'd like. As I said, we're going to probably do more streamings, so we know the projects that we will announce or keep working if they work out. So yes, this is removed in the DSi, because it uses a completely different SoC, system on chip. This is only present on the on the DS Lite. Indeed, the DSi bootloader is completely different. It doesn't have this hardware. It was removed. A lot of things were removed with DSi, like GBA support on the that was on the DS Lite. That was removed, so they could actually have greater hardware and deploy better the existing hardware, like the two cores, the ARM9 and the ARM7. They could be used for different tasks. Now, previously, the ARM7 was used to play GBA games, like on the GBA port. Now on the DSi, that is used for security. That is used for input output, and yeah, actually some security measures like locking registers and stuff like that. So I invite you to check other prints we have. We have breakout boards for Nintendo DS cards. We have breakout boards that we're playing with for some other prints. Let me show you one now that you're here, so you can see them in full animation shape. This is a breakout board. I just put this into a cartridge and use it to sniff the connections and other cool stuff. There's some. Sure, Macho. Have a good day. And oh well, good night over here. And see you on the next one. Open AGB firmware. Yeah, I think I thought about it. But not really into it. So. Alright, so y'all got the firmware. And that's excellent, because basically now you can follow the steps. We will check, everything's fine. Important if you can do a firmware dump of your stock firmware if you want. It's not going to change anything if you brick. You can brick by flashing Flashme or by flashing your stock firmware. It doesn't really matter at all. So, but it's fine to have your own dump of the firmware, and as you said, it's that small chip with a socket, and that's pretty much it. So thanks everyone to see you in the next one. We'll be working on some of the projects, keep iterating on this one, and yeah, there we go. There's the firmware patch Nighthack has just shared with you, so you can go check it out and follow up the all the stuff that you need to know. It is very important to install the no auto version, otherwise you will brick your DS when you, because you're patching a file that you shouldn't patch. Thanks Strand Zero, I'm glad you like it. Also those thanks I will forward them to Nico and Garycom, sort of, because they have worked I really hard on these two, so yeah, I think there are good things to come, and mods and stuff like that, hardware, who knows, preservation stuff perhaps on the DS platform. Yeah, we have some interesting projects on the front. Alright, I think we should leave it here, unless someone asks any final truly unanswered question. Otherwise, we leave it here. Thanks everyone for watching. Go check out Lost Nintendo History Twitter account. Follow it to kind of stay updated with news. And might as well follow Nico and I guess on Twitter we are pretty active, so if we are working on something, thank you, Mr. Starfire. So yeah, basically, if we work on something else, we will post it over there. We just post general stuff, firmware, and the stuff. Yep, as people saying, see y'all. Thank you too for watching. Hope you found it useful. You haven't minded that the button didn't work and all that stuff. And feel free to ask us over Twitter if you have any further question. You may contact us over GitHub, open an issue if you have any problem. Stay safe, don't break your DSs, and see you in the next one.